I think we were partway through analyzing a function. So weren't we looking at this one? And we had already determined that the domain was everything except negative 3. You remember that? And we had a vertical asymptote at negative 3. And that horizontal asymptote, we'd already determined that, I think, 2. Where did you say that was?
2.
At y equals 2. Because if x gets really, really big, these are insignificant. So we basically have 2x's over 1x. So we asymptote to 2. And that helped us determine the range, because if we have a horizontal asymptote at 2, whatever this curve looks like, and I haven't graphed the curve yet, but we're going to have y going to be everything except 2. So my range is this. I think that's where we were. Is that about right? Okay, so now we're going to talk about the end behavior. Now remember, the end behavior is what happens to this picture, what happens to the y's as x gets really, really big and really, really small. Well, I think it would be helpful to have a picture here. So let's see. Are there any easy points we could plot? Well, I can't let x be negative 3. That's a no-no. That's a vertical asymptote. I could plug in anything, but what if I plug in 0? What happens if I just plug in 0?
Negative
1/3. And what's that point called? That point right there is called the what?
Y-intercept.
That's my y-intercept, right? So that didn't maybe ask me for it, but I'm going to go ahead and write it down. That's my y-intercept. Does that help me at all?
Yes.
Do you have any idea what this picture looks like?
Let me go like this.
Does it make sense to you that it looks like that, at least on this side of the asymptote, that it would look like that?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you think about on this side of the asymptote? What do you think it might look like? You got a guess, don't you, that it's right up here like this?
Mm-hmm.
Could you verify that if you were at all unsure? I'm not unsure. I think you're dead on. But if I were a little bit worried about that, what could I always do?
Plug in points.
Plug in some points. Right, just plot a couple points. No, nothing special. Just pick a couple of values and plug them in and see what happens. Now, with that picture, can I tell my end behavior? Now, remember, end behavior. What is happening to y as x goes off the page this way? Can you tell me what's happening? What's it approaching? 2. And remember, we indicate whether it's from the bottom or the top. So this one's 2 from the bottom. And as we go this way, x approaches negative infinity. As we go off the page this way, what's happening? It's approaching
2 from the top.
2 from the top. And that's your end behavior.
Why wouldn't like each of them have their own end behavior? Like they kind of have like each of them has 2 ends, right?
Well, when we talk about end behavior, we're talking about x approaching infinity or negative infinity, and that only happens out here and out here. So you're talking about this, which is x approaching negative 3. Okay, so there are, we have notation for that, we can talk about that, but that isn't considered end behavior. End behavior is what happens as x gets 2 over 0. All right, continuity. Would you consider this thing to be a continuous function?
No.
No. It is not continuous. Would everybody agree with that? It has a non-removable discontinuity at x equals negative 3, or what your book calls an infinite discontinuity at x equals negative 3. Is it continuous on any intervals at all? Does it have any continuity? The whole function is not. But could we say that this piece right here is continuous? So we could say it's continuous on the interval negative infinity to negative 3. Would you agree with that? And it's also continuous on the interval from negative 3 to infinity. So overall, the function is not continuous. But there are sections of it that are, intervals of it that are continuous. All right. Would you say this function is increasing or decreasing? Let's think about it for a second. Robert?
Both.
Both? You're with Robert on this one? I'd like you to take your pencil and I'd like you to trace this curve. Which direction am I going? Up. Which direction am I going? This function doesn't have any decreasing parts. This function is increasing on its entire domain. Now remember, this is not included in the domain. So when all the values of the function for which it's defined, it's increasing. So it is increasing on those two intervals, negative infinity to negative 3, and negative 3 to infinity. We can't say that it's increasing on the entire, negative infinity to infinity, because it's not even defined here. That breaks it. But it is definitely increasing on both of those intervals.
But if it was like flipped and the other two quadrants of it broken up on the asymptotes, it would be decreasing.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Because then your pencil would be going down as you do it. Does this curve have any extrema? Now remember, extrema are defined as points on the curve that are higher than all the points immediately surrounding it. So like that would be a maximum. Does this one have any of those? No extreme. All right, let's try the same thing. Let's go through all the same steps with this function. We need to figure out its domain. Yep, and asymptotes. We'll start with that. All right. What's the domain of this function? Can anybody tell me? What's the domain, Mr. Burnham?
Negative 4 included.
Exactly. Your domain is from negative 4 to infinity. Can somebody besides Mr. Bernauer explain that? How did he get that this was the domain? How did he figure that out? Andrew?
Because it'll be like zero. It'll be, otherwise it'd be negative. You can't have I in it.
Yeah, exactly. We gotta keep it real. And if we're gonna keep it real, then doesn't x plus 4 have to be bigger than or equal to 0? And that means x itself has to be bigger than or equal to negative 4, which we would write this way. So I don't know what's going on in this picture, but it all starts right here, right? There's nothing over here. The whole, it starts right there. In fact, if you put negative 4 in, don't you get 0? Mm-hmm. So that's a point on the curve, that point right there. Anybody know what this looks like? Is it like a what? Well, it's like a sideways parabola. It looks like this. We're going to talk more about that today. It looks like that. But, again, some of you remember that. Some of you know that. What if you don't? What could you do? If you really wanted to get an idea for what this thing looked like, what could you do? Plot a few points. You can always plot points. So if you put in 0, you get 2, right? So this is the point 0, 2. And then you could put in, let's see, 5 maybe would be a good choice to put in, because that would give you 3, and so on and so on. You could plot some points. That's what it looks like. That is a function, right? Passes the vertical line test. Does it have any asymptotes? No, it does not. It does not have any asymptotes. An asymptote, remember kids, is a line that the curve approaches, or not necessarily a line, it's something, I'll say line. A line that the curve approaches but doesn't intersect. This does not have that. This is going to keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger forever. There's no ceiling on it, in other words. What's this range? What can you tell me about the y values? If that's the picture, and I think it is, Sir says the range is 0 to positive infinity. Is he right? Yep, he sure is. Good work. Good work. End behavior. Remember, end behavior is you're describing what happens to the y values as you go all the way to the right and all the way to the left. What happens to our y values? Well, first of all, do we have end behavior this way?
No.
No, we don't have that one.
Just be positive infinity.
He's exactly right, because this just keeps going up, 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 up. Forever. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. As you let x get bigger, y is going to get bigger. Perfect. All right. Continuity. Would you say this function is continuous? Yep, on its entire domain. So it is continuous on the interval from 0, from negative 4 to infinity. Continuous on its entire domain. What else is it doing on its entire domain?
Increasing.
Exactly. Perfect. Any extrema here? Actually, it does have a minimum, doesn't it? It has an absolute and a local minimum or relative minimum. This is absolute minimum and relative minimum at the point 0, 0. Or not 0, 0.
Negative 4, 0.
Yeah. That will look like a graph, I think, to you. And we are going to functions. Study them a little more. They are on, they're in your book, and they are on, they start on page 106. Okay, so you're welcome to use that as a resource too. Alright, so what we're going to do is we are not going to fill out every piece of information on here. You're going to be able to do some of that on your own. We'll do a couple of them, but we're not going to do every single one of them. You are absolutely responsible for knowing the name of the function, the equation of the function, and the graph of the function. Okay? So you absolutely have to know that. So here we go. The identity function. Talked about this a little bit when we talked about symmetry. The identity function is y equals x, and it is that perfect diagonal through the origin, quadrants 3 and 1. That's called the identity function. Linear functions are a variation of that. So, for example, we could do plus 1, and that would move this up 1, and it would just be a line in a different position. So every line you draw is some variation of this. Picked up, made steeper, upside down, whatever. Your book calls this the identity function. If you referred to it as the linear function, that would be fine too. That's the shape. That's the graph. That's the equation. All right. We'll find a more interesting one to analyze. The squaring function. The squaring function is also known as the quadratic function. Its equation is y equals x squared, and it is your parabola. So let's do a quick analysis of that. What's the domain of the squaring function, the quadratic function? What's your domain? All real numbers, that's right, negative infinity to infinity. No breaks in that, no stopping or starting, it goes on forever and ever. How about the range? What's my range?
Zero to
infinity. Doesn't it start right here? It doesn't go negative, does it?
No.
So that would be my range. Is that okay with everybody? The range. Would you say it's continuous?
Yes.
Yep, on its entire domain, right? Continuous on the interval from negative infinity to infinity. What about increasing and decreasing?
Well, wouldn't that depend?
Okay, so it's going to be both, right? Where is it increasing?
Negative to zero.
From zero
to
infinity? And where is it decreasing?
Negative infinity to zero.
Remember, kids, when we talk about these intervals, when we set up these intervals, except for range, we're talking about x values. Okay? So x values, we're increasing where x is 0 to infinity. This thing's going up. We're decreasing from where x is negative infinity to 0. What's next? Symmetry. Does this thing have any symmetry? You can eyeball it. I think it does. What symmetry does it have? This way,
y-axis.
Which means y-axis. So it's symmetric about the y-axis.
Mm-hmm.
So it's symmetry, is y-axis symmetry, which vocabulary word makes it what kind of a function if it has symmetry about the y-axis? This is in your symmetry notes, it should be. Even, it's an even function. If it has symmetry about the y-axis, it is considered an even function. Is it bounded? Now remember, bounded means it's contained. It has a ceiling and a floor. This is not bounded, but it is bounded below. So I'm going to say that. I'm going to say bounded below. Remember, you never say bounded unless it's completely contained. But you can say bounded below by y equals 0. So its floor is at 0. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Extrema. Local extrema. Does it have any local maximums and minimums? The origin. So it has a local or a relative. Those words are used interchangeably, so be ready for either one. Local or relative min at the origin. And isn't that also the absolute minimum? Does it have a horizontal asymptote?
No.
Nope. Does it have a vertical asymptote?
No.
Nope. Does it have any behavior? Yes, it does. What is the end behavior? Remember, this is the way we always write end behavior. What is it?
When x is going to infinity, y is going to infinity, and x is going to negative infinity, y is going to negative infinity.
Not negative infinity.
Over infinity.
Positive, yep. Both sides are going up, right? So both ends are positive infinity. So this says, as x gets big, what happens to y? It gets big. As x gets little, what happens to y? It still gets big. Right? Now, you guys, okay, we just went through all that stuff for this function, right? And that wasn't hard. Do not memorize all of this. Oh my gosh, there's 12 of them. You can't possibly memorize all that. Just be able to figure it out if you're asked. Okay? All you have to memorize is the name of the function, the equation of the function, and the picture of the function. That needs to be memorized. If you know that, basically, if you know the picture, you can answer all of these questions. Agreed? So please, don't stress about that and, you know, fill your mind up with too much junk. All right, let's try the cubing function. What's the cubing function look like?
Y
equals x cubed. Is your equation,
like a squiggly.
And it's a squiggly through the origin. Now, obviously, we can add, subtract, multiply, put stuff in there, make it negative, whatever, and that's going to change the location of it and the shape of it, but the general shape is going to stay this. That's a cubing shape. We did not fill in all the characteristics. We didn't do the whole analysis for the linear function, the identity function. But if we did, wouldn't these for the linear function be very similar to this one? Because
mm-hmm.
they're basically the same graph. This one just has a curve in it. The other one doesn't. All right, what's next? The reciprocal function. Well, we've actually already talked about this one today. What do you think the equation of the reciprocal function is?
1 over x.
1 over x. So y equals 1 over x is your equation. And just looking at that equation, you know you're going to have an asymptote where? You know you're going to have an asymptote at x equals 0. Can x be 0? No. Now we're also going to have an asymptote at 1 equals 0. Can someone explain that to me? How did I know that? What was I thinking? What's going through my brain? Robert?
So there's no like x like.
Exactly. So if I tried to set this equation equal to 0, that would not be possible, right? So if nothing makes that equal 0, then y can't be 0. Okay. Now what else? So yeah, that's part of the graph. If x is positive, y will be positive, right?
Yep.
So the points are going to be in quadrant 1. And if x is negative, y would be negative in quadrant 3. When I said we'd already looked at the reciprocal function today, remember that thing we started with? Wasn't it a variation of this? Asymptotes were a different spot, but it was that curve. So we moved the asymptotes by putting numbers into the equation plus whatever. Good. All right, let's analyze this one. Here we go. What's the domain?
It'll be,
Well, the domain, you have one domain, but it's written in two pieces.
Yeah.
Because it breaks. So your domain would be negative infinity to 0, mm-hmm. and 0 to infinity?
Yeah.
What about your range?
Same
thing, isn't it? Everything except 0? Don't let me go too fast. You have to be able to do this on your own. Are you okay with that? Continuous. In the big picture, is this a continuous function?
No.
It has what your book calls an infinite discontinuity at x equals 0, mm-hmm. or a non-removable discontinuity at x equals 0. But we can say it is continuous on a couple of intervals. It's continuous from negative infinity to 0 and from 0 to infinity. Would you agree with that?
Yep.
Brayden?
So like if we were to be doing this on test and it says continuous, would we write no or continuous, like would you write like how?
Yes, you would say it's continuous on this interval.
Okay.
Or on these two intervals, I should say. Increasing or decreasing? It is decreasing on its entire domain. So it is decreasing from negative infinity to 0 and from 0 to infinity. Is it your pencil going down? Every piece you draw, every single part of that you draw, your pencil is going down. Does this guy have any symmetry? Ooh, this is an interesting one. What do you think? Does it have any symmetry?
Would it have symmetries about the origin, x-axis, and y-axis?
All right, let's start with the origin. If it has symmetry about the origin, that would mean that we can make x and y both negative, right? So, let's say, look at my equation. This would be the point 1, 1. Would you agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
What point would this be? So we change the signs on both x and y. We got our picture back again. I think it does have symmetry about the origin. This would be the point 2, 1 half. And this would be the point negative 2, negative 1 half. So I think it has symmetry about the origin. Now, I'm not sure about the x and y axis though, because if I have symmetry about the y axis, let's say, I need to be able to fold my picture over and be on top of myself. And I'm not, am I?
No.
Nope. So I don't have y axis and I don't have x axis symmetry. Do I have symmetry about the identity line though? If I could magically fold my whiteboard on this crease right here, would the curve fold up onto itself?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So this also has symmetry about the identity line. By the way, vocabulary, if I'm symmetric about the origin, I am odd. This is an odd function. It has symmetry about the origin. What else? Boundedness.
Is it asymptote?
Well, let's start about the easy ones first. Is this bounded above?
No.
Nope. Is it bounded below?
No.
Nope. Sometimes we get confused because if we look at just this part, is just this part bounded below?
Yes.
And is just this part bounded above?
Yes.
In general, I'm going to say this isn't bounded. If you want to get really specific and say bounded below on the interval from 0 to infinity, you could do that. Bounded above on the interval from negative infinity to 0, you could say that. I'm not going to. I'm just going to say it's not bounded. It does not have a ceiling or a floor. Goes on forever and ever. Extrema. Mm-hmm. Relative minimums and maximums? No. No locals, no absolutes. Horizontal asymptote? Yep, we got one of those at y equals 0. And we have a vertical at x equals 0. And then our end behavior. And again, this is the way we write it every single time. Do not get confused. What can you tell me about the end behavior?
When x is going towards infinity, it's going to 0 from above.
Yep. Perfect. Perfect. And what about the other way?
Zero
from above. And 0 from above. So we just analyzed another one. Does anybody have a question about that? All right, let's get some more shapes in here. Square root, we kind of already talked about that one.
Y equals the square root of x.
So y equals the square root of x. Y equals the square root of x is your equation.
And it looks like the
top half of a sideways parabola. Yep, this one's starting at the origin. Everybody okay with that? And then the exponential. Anybody have any idea what the exponential function looks like? Your exponential, and no, E does not stand for exponential. What is that E? Who knows what that E is?
Natural
that's
order.
What?
Natural
law. Well, it's the base of the natural law, and it's you say his name Euler. Actually, it's Euler's constant. And does anybody know it's irrational? It's irrational, just like pi is irrational. You know how we say pi is like approximately 3.14? Anybody know what E is approximately? Oh, you absolutely can get it on your calculator. 2.718. That's an approximation. That's an irrational number that goes on forever and ever. Now, when we talk about the exponential function in general, we use y, we say y equals e to the x. But an exponential is anything raised to the x power. So that would be exponential. This would be exponential. So we don't just have exponentials that are e to the x. We can have any kinds of numbers. But this is kind of the general form that we use. Anybody know what it looks like? What does an exponential function look like when you graph it?
Isn't that the entire exponential?
Isn't it what?
The entire part.
Okay, so let's talk about what Sir said. First of all, we love the fact that he's trying to figure this stuff out. He said, would it be an entire sideways parabola? Now, the answer is no, because that isn't a function.
Oh.
And this conversation is about the basic family of functions, right? So that doesn't have a place in this conversation.
Yeah.
Now, that is something, and we can do stuff with that, but that is not a function. Let's talk about that for a minute. Yeah.
I'll be honest, I use my calculator, but is it like, is it half of the,
Not really, but I see what you're saying. It looks like this. Now, one point that we know for sure is part of this is this point right here. What point would that be? If x is 0, y will be 1. And let's talk about this for a second. E is 2.718. If you raise that to a power, will it ever be negative?
No.
Can you raise a positive to a power and get a negative?
No.
So therefore, this is an asymptote. Now, it's only asymptotic on this side because this is where the curve is decreasing. Here, it's shooting up into space. But you have an asymptote at y equals 0, a horizontal asymptote at y equals 0. There is no vertical asymptote. That's it. That's your exponential. Any question about that? All right, we're halfway through. You're doing great. The natural logarithm function.
Isn't natural log mean?
Natural log is log base e, so your equation would be ln x or log base e x. Those are the natural logarithms. But just as this was the shape of all exponentials, this is the shape of all logarithms. Log base 10, log base 5, log base whatever. You just in general say it's ln. You remember what that one looks like? You talked about that one last year. Well, it's actually the inverse of that one. So it has a vertical asymptote at x equals 0, contains the point 1 comma 0, and looks like this. So this is the logarithmic shape, and this is the exponential shape.
Going to refer to them in like relation to each other, would you say like inverse?
They are inverses, yeah. They are inverses of each other. Exponentials and logarithms are inverses of each other, which we're going to spend more time later on in this chapter talking about that. But basically what that means is all of your ordered pairs are flipped. So what was 0, 1 is now 1, 0. What was y equals 0 is now x equals 0.
So what they call increasing.
Yes, this is an increasing function, and so is this one. Yep, they're increasing on their entire domains.
never decrease?
Not these guys. Now, obviously, we can make alterations to them. We can put a negative in front of it or something. But in their pure form, no, they're not. They'll never be this. All right, the sine function. Y equals sine x. And when you write that, please, 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 please don't say sin x, even though that's what it looks like. That's our equation, y equals sine x. Now, did you graph between an exponential function slash?
Yeah, no.
No, okay. That's okay, that's fine, because we spent a lot of time doing it. So, in general, we're not going to get real specific here, just the general shape. You're going to oscillate back and forth, the sine and cosine, between negative 1 and 1. The sine's going to look like this. Okay. It's going to be on a math group t-shirt this year. Now I'm going to go ahead and sketch the cosine right now. And then we're going to talk about how we're going to keep them apart. Because you do have to keep them apart, even though they are so similar to each other.
So is sine bounded by above and below, and then cosine is 1.
Now, would you say both of these functions are bounded?
Yes.
Yeah, above by 1, below by negative 1. These are bounded functions. What's the difference? Aren't they just shifts of each other? Right? They're shifts of each other? So you just got to remember that the sine goes through the origin.
Yep.
The cosine does not, right? The cosine starts up here at the top. So being the good Catholic girl that I am, original sin, sine goes through the origin. That's how I remember. The sine goes through the origin. Now, when we get to this later on, we're going to talk about what these horizontal labels are. But for now, I don't want you to worry about that. I want you to know the general shapes. They are essentially the same curve. Right? Now, these two are a little tricky when it comes to talking about extrema, relative maxes, and mins. Why?
Because
there are infinitely many of them, right? There are infinitely many maximums and minimums. Here, and then just keep going.
Is there any point you would find on the sine and cosine outside of the origin of the sine function? Like, to do like that first curve up, uh-huh. Can we find the value of that?
Oh, absolutely.
Without a calculator?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. Okay, I can tell you right now, that's pi over 2. And this is pi, and this is 3 pi over 2, and this is 2 pi. Yeah, we'll find that. Those are important points.
Okay.
Now, those change when you start doing things like this, you know, sticking numbers into the equation. We'll do all that. We'll do all that, trust me. You get so sick of graphing those things. All right, let's go. Last page, absolute value function. This one you did a lot last year. What does it look like? What shape is it? Absolute value. Absolute value is a V. So y equals the absolute value of x. It has, remember the squaring function, which was the parabola? They're pretty much identical in terms of their analysis. increasing, decreasing, continuous domain range, all that's pretty much the same. That's a value. Greatest integer function. Now, there are a couple of different notations for greatest integer function. I like that notation myself, but your book does something like this. So if you got those brackets surrounding it, that's the greatest integer function. Now, what does it look like? This is that step function. So, you put a dot at the origin and march over one unit and put an open circle. Then we step up, put another dot, march over one more. And we just keep doing that. That is your greatest integer function. Now we're going to talk about that for a second so that you have a sense of what is this thing? What are you doing?
What else is that used for?
Okay, we're going to talk about that. So let me give you a minute to get the shape down. Notice that for the greatest integer function, we have a closed dot at the end. Let's talk about it.
Does it step at every integer or?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. Hence the name greatest integer function. Now, obviously, like I keep saying over and over again, that can be modified by putting numbers into the equation. Like I put a 2 out here in front or something, that's going to modify it. But let's talk about what that means. When we say the greatest integer function, we mean the output will be an integer. Okay? And it is an integer closest to but not greater than the input number. So the input number can be anything, but the output functions are input output machines. You feed it an X, it gives you a Y. So I can feed it whatever X I want. But the Y that comes out is going to be the integer closest to what I gave it, closest to what I plugged in, but not greater than. So, for example, if I put in a 1/2, what is it going to give me? The integer closest to 1/2, but not greater than 1/2. 0? Well, what if I put in 3/4?
0.
So in other words, any x value between 0 and 1 is going to give me a 0. But what happens for x values between 1 and 2? It gives me 1. So that's how this picture got generated. Now, Sir is saying, okay, so what kind of possible practical application could that have? How many of you have ever mailed a letter like snail mail? Like you put a stamp on it and you mailed it, right? Okay. If you mail a letter that weighs anything between 0 and an ounce, you got to put 1 stamp on that envelope, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
But what happens if it weighs more than an ounce? Now you got to put another stamp on it?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a step function. 0 to 1 is 1 stamp. 1 to 2 is 2 stamps, and so on and so on and so on. Another example, when you park in a parking garage, do you pay by the minute? No. If you're anything from, I'm not making this up for a parking garage, but if you're anything between 0 and 1 hour, you pay $5. And then what happens? If you're between 1 and 2 hours, now you're going to pay, I don't know, $8 or, you know, whatever. So it steps in intervals like that. So those are examples of step functions.
So like if you're to write like an equation like a parking garage, say it's $5 and then $3 every hour,
yep.
you would have like a wire set of like plus five.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Yep. And yeah, so this would actually be up here at five and going that way. And there wouldn't be anything over there because it couldn't be negative in the parking garage. All right, and finally, one more, the logistic function. No, and that's a good point, sir. We have to be careful when we talk about the logistic function. We have to make sure that we are not confusing it with the logarithmic function, because they are totally different. The logistic function. Logistic function has an equation that looks like this. And when we graph it, it actually has two asymptotes. Horizontal asymptotes. It has a horizontal asymptote at zero and a horizontal asymptote at one. Spend some time writing equations of logistic functions, so variations of this. This is like the general form, just like all our things are general forms. We'll be putting numbers in there. That will be moving these asymptotes around, changing the direction of the function. But this is the basic. Now, let's go ahead and analyze this one in terms of all that stuff. Let's fill it all out. What's the domain?
All reals.
All real numbers. So we're going to answer that as an interval. So we'll say negative infinity to infinity. Mm-hmm. What about our range? What's our range for this guy?
Zero.
The range is just going to be 0 to 1, right? Continuous. Increasing or decreasing? Increasing on its entire domain. Does it have any symmetry? And when I say symmetry, I'm talking about our special symmetries. Nope. No x-axis, no y-axis, no origin, no identity. Bounded? This is the first one we've actually analyzed that is bounded.
Bounded between 0 and 1.
Okay, that's a good way of saying it. Bounded between y equals 0 and y equals 1. That's a great way of saying that. So, have we looked at any other functions that are bounded?
Yes.
Which ones?
Sine
and cosine are definitely bounded. That might be it. Local extrema? No, no absolute extrema. Horizontal asymptotes? Two of them, right? Two of them. Vertical asymptotes?
None.
And then our end behavior, the limit as x approaches infinity, and the limit as x approaches negative infinity. Tell me about that.
So as it approaches positive infinity, x is becoming equal to 1.
1 from the bottom, right? Perfect, beautiful.
0 from the top.
0 from the top. How about that, you guys? You got a handle on that now? You okay with that? All right,
we did not go through this with every function. Are we okay with that? Everybody understood all that?
Yes.
Why do you put a plus sign on the zero?
Because we're coming in from the top of zero, as opposed to something like this that would be coming in on the bottom of zero. So when you approach an asymptote, you can approach it from the top or the bottom. And so we use the little pluses and minuses to determine which one. On Thursday, on Thursday, you're going to have the opportunity to do an analysis like this with one of the BFFs, all right? And I'll do this. I'll pick the BFF, and I will draw its picture for you. So you don't have to have all these equations and everything memorized by Thursday. I will draw the picture. So I'll pick absolute value function. So I'll draw a picture for you, and then I will ask you all these questions, and you'll fill that in. Okay? I'm not saying it will be that, but that's what I will do. I will give you the picture so that you don't have to have it memorized yet. Eventually you do. But you do need to do this analysis. And I promise it won't be one of the wild and wacky ones.
So the bounds are also asymptotes in logistic function, right?
Yes.
Okay.
But they don't have, the bounds do not have to be asymptotes. So for example, in this one, we're bounded below, but not by an asymptote. But yes, the bounds can be asymptotes.
Asymptotes are just going to be getting as close as possible without. But it would still be continuous.
Yes.
Aren't necessarily.
Now horizontal ones.
Oh,
vertical ones break the curve, so they have continuations.
So asymptotes. Boundedness is not always an asymptote, but isn't an asymptote always like bounding something?
Horizontal, yes.
Okay. All right, so I think we'll stop.